south. For indeed, several people are against the inflation and they suggest the origin of the universe, not the Big Bang, but a bouncing universe that does not need the inflation. This is a membrane universe that clashed endlessly, and they clash, they separate, they evolve. We are here in this moment. Then the membranes are again going close to each other, and they clash once more here. So this would be this very striking suggestion. Of course, it is necessary to demonstrate, not impossible to demonstrate. This very striking suggestion should be in agreement with the cycle birth, growth, aging, death. Because in this case, we could have a circle in the production of our universe. For this reason, it's even more important to find an experimental proof of the inflection. Because if we find the experimental proof of the inflection, we can say that the origin was due to the Big Bang and not by a circular universe. Is the universe flat? Maybe, because from the boomerang experiments we have the data completely in agreement with the flat universe, but if we look at the other measurements, we are a bit discrepancy between the flat universe. Therefore, we must be careful before to say definitively that the universe is flat. Hubble constant is the, practically the velocity of the galaxies that expand far from us. And this is the constant I call less constant because we have a lot of measurements that are not in agreement among them. Now we are converging in a range between 55 and 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec. So maybe that this could be the final value, but it is not yet definitively demonstrated. How to arrive to the other side of the bridge between the Big Bang and biology? We have the planetary system formation, the planets formation, and thanks to Kepler, an observatory that is, was flying, we have detected, this is dated May 2016, we detected many thousands of planets. And the blue points are the confirmed planets, and the red points are the candidates planets. So we have roughly 4,000 planets detected. The very good news is that the water we have in the Earth is coming from the nebula that was present in our neighboring before the formation of the solar system. This means that the water is present everywhere in the universe because we have a lot of nebulas, molecular nebulas in the universe. Therefore, the presence of water is common in the universe. This means that the solar system is not an exception. It's simply one of the many star systems with the planets. Moreover, we have, thanks to Kepler, detected, for instance, this planet, which is the most Earth-like planet ever discovered, and could be home for alien life, because the temperature is just right for liquid water to flow. Kepler looked at the distance of 3,000 light years. Therefore, they detected the 4,000 planets, more or less, and in the habitable zone, means in the places where the life could be possible, they detected 30 planets. Therefore, if we take our galaxy and we take the habitable zone in green, not very close to the center because the radiation is too strong in order to permit the life, and not very far because it is too far and not possible to have explosions of a supernova that give the possibility to send heavy elements in the interstellar space and then to form planets. So in this habitable zone, which is 3.3 kiloparsec cubic, we have detected 30 Earth size planets. Since the habitable zone of the galaxy is 330 kiloparsec cubic, we have in this zone the possibility of having 4 in 10 to 5 means 400,000 planets in the habitable zone. And the lower limit for the planets like the Earth is at least 3,000. So it means that we have a possibility of having many companions. The news is that the planets around other stars are the rule rather than exception. Therefore, since the number of stars in the galaxy is of order of 200 billions, we can expect to have in the galaxy at least 1 billion of 1,000 billions of planets. Therefore, we have a lot of planets in which probably we could have something in movement. A few wise freethinkers in the past centuries arrived at conclusions that we are astonishing in the light of modern science. One was Siddhartha Gautama, or Shakyamuni, between the 6th and 5th century before Christ, and Giordano Bruno, 16th century after Christ. The Lotus Sutra, central text of Mahayana Buddhism, exposes grandiose vision of the universe through the concept of major systems of worlds, a concept on huge scale that implies both the existence of countless galaxies and the possibility of a sentient life on other planets other than our own. And Mr. Giordano Bruno was a monk, burned alive in Campo dei Fiori by the Saint Inquisition, because he wrote in the publishing in 1584 this book, The Infinito Universo et Mondi. And this was predicting that we had effectively the universe with a lot of worlds, like he said, like our own. And moreover, he said, whether we like it or not, we are the cause of ourselves. Being born in this world, we fall into the illusion of the senses. We believe in what appears. We ignore that we are blind and deaf. Then the fear attacks us and we forget that we are divine. We can change the course of events. This was enough to be burdened by the Saint Inquisition. Of course, we must wait scientific confirmation for the alien life. We must wait even more for the discovery of intelligent life. But the number of planets is growing very fast. Thus, I can reasonably affirm here, take my responsibility, that the universe is full of life, hoping to avoid to be burned alive. Formation of the condition for developing the life. The common ancestor was already said by Luigi in his talk and in other talks. We have the common ancestor for the terrestrial life. Therefore, all the living beings in the earth are coming from the same origin. And we have the formation of our planet around 4.5 billion years ago. But after the slow under bracket, it depends on the on which kind of time we consider. In any case, we arrive at this point 35 years ago. In only 35 millions of years, we have a big bang of evolution. In this moment, there were generated all the living beings actually present in our Earth. So it was probably due to some some event, maybe the radiation of the sun, the formation of a special kind of atmosphere, etc., etc. We don't know exactly for what, but we had a big explosion of the life in the planet. Development of intelligent life. What intelligent humanity is doing? Luigi last day made a list of damage we made in the last 15 years, 17 years more or less from 1950. And the problem of modern time is pollution, global warming, insane consumption of energy, deforestation, the immense richness of multinationals, the extreme poverty of so many people, immigration, etc., etc. So it cannot be considered isolated because all these problems are interconnected as everything in the universe. And this is what we are looking at our sea oceans. A huge swirling pile of trash in the Pacific Ocean is growing faster than expected, and is now three times the size of France. Three times the size of France. Our trash harms the deepest fish in the ocean. Humans have produced 18 trillion pounds of plastic since the 50s. That's equal in size to 1 billion elephants. So the comments are unusable. But we are so clever that we are polluting even the space, because we are launching satellite rockets, etc., and we don't pay attention to the rubbish, the garbage. And we have now 11,000 objects greater than 10 centimeters, and 100,000 objects between 1 and 10 centimeters in the space. Humans are so intelligent that they manage to contaminate even the space, which is the only escape from the planet. Because if we follow in this way, we could not escape from the planet, because we can have an impact with these objects, and the impact at a velocity of 36,000 kilometers per hour is fatal. It's necessary only 1 gram of particle to destroy one spacecraft. So the biological balance is menaced. The planet is infested, perhaps irreparably, by one species, Homo sapiens, predator, prolific, marginalized other species, 1 billion at the beginning of 900, 2 billion in 950, more than 6 billion in 2000, and this is the last data coming from United Nations. We are now 7.5 billion in all the world, and in 2100 we will have more than 11 billion of inhabitants, most of them coming from Africa and Asia. Okay. So the planet Earth could endure perhaps 2 billion people. So we have a serious problem of overpopulation and all the consequences like pollution, food, etc., etc. Yes, it is not enough to behave well. We must reduce our number unless we seriously think to colonize the solar system. With intelligent human activity, the temperature of the Earth is growing, as already remarked by Luigi and the other, and there is no doubt that the Earth is getting warmer. Also, Pope Francesco is admonishing humanity for this. And since I'm a physicist, I have an experimental proof of a global warming of the planet against skeptics. So, someone in the future will look at our species as we look at the death of dinosaurs. Then, if we look for intelligent life in the universe, why we should look for those like ours? Conclusions. After this long personal journey, I can conclude that these are the conclusions. What means? The truth is written in the book of the nature. We must learn to read this book. Say something more. The truth is, we have a lot of models for interpreting the experimental data by the light of science, but depending on the hypothesis, the results could run against the experiments. Then, in order to be acceptable, models can take into account and justify all the available data, and not what you wish. Ethical and social responsibility of the scientists. This is a part of my life in which I am involved, and I try to do the best. USP, the Unione Scienziati per il Disarmo, is a non-profit organization of scientists and researchers founded in 1982. Objective is to provide information and analysis to the public and institutions in the field of arms and disarmament control, including information on the environmental impact and the costs human being following development and dissemination of weapons. One of the USP founder member, Carlo Bernardini, passed away just a few days ago, and he was professor of mathematical method of physics at La Sapienza University of Roma, had been friend and the students of Edoardo Amaldi and Giorgio Salvini. He was one of the last moral heirs of Via Panisperna boys. I was student of Carlo Bernardini and later friend, and I was student also by of the Edoardo Amaldi and Giorgio Salvini. So we have a continuity in our chain. Commitment. USP members are convinced that this task is a moral imperative for scientists and that is part of their social responsibility. USP collaborate in many other international organizations, and especially with the PADWASH conferences on science and business world. I will say what is PADWASH. The PADWASH movement was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1995, together with the Saint Joseph Rotblat. He was the unique escaped from Los Alamos when he understood that they were preparing the atomic bomb. He had serious problems, but he was really escaping because he said, in my name, not. And when the Nobel Prize was given to PADWASH movement, the General Secretary was Carlo Francesco Calogero, which was also my professor of theoretical physics in Sapienza University, and was also rival in the football matches because I was playing in the Spazio team and he was playing in the professor team. So. And now we have Paolo Costa Lamusino, which is the General Secretary of PADWASH since August 2002. He is also a member of USP. For instance, Mikhail Gorbachev invited the people of USP, thanks to their work, in a conference in occasion of the unilateral moratorium that he started in 1985. So that means that our activities are rather important. The profound respect for human nature is the spring that pushes the members of USP to undertake a journey that is a beacon of universal peace. And among them are agnostic, atheist, religious of all creeds, but who have in common the strong determination to work for a better world, free from the danger of the total destruction. This is a real danger. The chicken blood. Enrico Fermi is willing to use the blood of the chicken, the atomic bomb, to counter the Nazi threat. On the other part, Franco Rosetti, who refused to go to Los Alamos, that is not willing to use chicken blood, the atomic bomb, even to counter the hated Nazi threat. Franco Rasetti has an absolute ethical vision. Weapons of mass destruction are evil and cannot even be constructed as a deterrent against that other absolute evil that is Nazism. Scientists have a special social responsibility. They cannot work for evil. They cannot sell the soul to the evil. They cannot use chicken blood even to get the best results possible. There is a growing awareness that the human beings must have absolute priority and that the human growth is much more important than economic growth. We started to become aware that in our modern societies oriented towards information and characterized by a huge flow of knowledge, there must be an equally great flow of wisdom that allows use appropriate knowledge, a wisdom that provides to the individual and to the society a direction and precise objectives. Scientific development alone cannot bring happiness, nor can socialism or capitalism. There is something wrong in this historical moment. It does not matter how many conferences you make, how much emphasis on ethics, how many lessons in psychology or philosophy should be held. Something essential is missing. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, in a sense of the view, writes, "We must understand that somewhere along our path we have taken the wrong way. Today, humanity as a whole is richer than ever was, than it ever was. We enjoy abundance and ease never before achieved. However, we lack something indefinable but basic. The feeling of ourselves as human beings is becoming more and more rarefied. We lost something that was one of our mysterious prerogatives. Humanity is in the wrong path, as I showed before the beginning of the talk. So where do we come from? Where are we going? Why we are here? Many people claim that the prevailing mood nowadays is a feeling of impotence. The individual seems to have no influence on political, economic, and environmental decisions. After all, what can you do in the face of the most powerful institutions that manage our world? But this sense of impotence only feeds a vicious circle that aggravates the state of things and reinforces that sense of futility felt by common people. Vice versa, if you listen to the philosophy of the 3,000 kingdoms in a single moment of life, of the Lotus Sutra applicable to daily life, we realize that we are not powerless. This principle teaches us that we are that the internal determination of an individual can transform anything. And we have many examples of this. Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, Maria Teresa of Calcutta, Bangari Maathai. The infinite potential and the dignity inherent in the life of every human being find their maximum expression in this teaching. People apparently distant from belonging to different states and different political systems assert that a human being is not a tall, impotent creature to be pitied. Alexander Yakovlev, for instance, the Russian politician defined by many as the architect of perestroika, answering some questions about the future of his country, expressed a similar concept. Today, even the most objective scientific rationalism teaches us that if we do not recognize the value of each single individual, the human race is destined to sure destruction. The roots of racism extend in depth, and the movements that feed racial hatred for purpose political, economic, religious, and are always present in our society. The ideological and philosophical emptiness pushes people to look for an identity in their own ethnic group. In this sense, religion can be important as long as it does not become a demonic force. Religion must exist for the good of the people, not at the expenses of the people, as well as society must also exist for the good of the people. Do we want to end the human race or give up the war? A first significant step in that direction would have been, and is, renouncing all nuclear weapons. We make the present appeal as human beings to other human beings. Remember your humanity and forget all the rest. This is the talk of Joseph Roblat at the magisterial lecture in the occasion of the Nobel Prize for the Peace in 1995. So, we have the manifesto, very well known manifesto, Russell Einstein. I jumped to read, you can find as you wish in each place in the internet. And we invited the Congress, they said, and throw its scientists from all over the world, people to sign the following motion. And this was the motion against the nuclear weapons. And there is another not so famous manifesto, the Toda manifesto was Joseph Toda was the second president of the International Soka Gakkai. In September 57, on front of 50,000 young people, he declared his manifest against the nuclear weapons. And this is the synthesis. We, the citizens of the world, have the unviolable right to life. Anyone who tries to jeopardize this right is a devil, a demon, a monster. And we have also the Manifesto of Verge, written by Paul Dirac, Peter Capizza, Antonio Zivivi in August 82 in Erice. It aroused the interest of Deng Xiaoping, who was president of China, Michael Gorbachev, Olof Palme, Sandro Pertini, Ronald Reagan, Pierre Trudeau. They gave life to various initiatives for a science without secrets and without borders. This manifesto has been signed by more than 100,000 scientists of all the world during the Erice schools. 3 years ago, as a Buddhist, but not for making propaganda, we made an exhibition in Roma, Senza Atomica, Without Atomic Bomb, and 70,000 people visited this exhibition. 45,000 of them were students. It was a very exciting event, and it marked a lot of the students especially. And now this event is circulating in Italy, even in the smaller version, in which is possible to present in a room of about 60 square meters. So it is going in all the small towns that ask to have this exhibition. What can we do for our happiness and for the happiness of everybody? There is the legend of the hummingbird. Today, some argue that we are not able to influence anything, as I said before, but this is not true, because this is the legend, the African legend of the hummingbird. The ancient African legend that tells us that in the forest of the great trees, a fire breaks out, the high flame flares up and the sky up into the sky, and the wind spread fire. Scared of the animals, begin to run away and trying to save themselves on the top of the mountain covered with the snow, and the animals except one, all the animals except one, the little hummingbird. The hummingbird is a tiny and delicate bird from fast flapping of wings. While others seek refuge, the hummingbird makes for the lakes. It is here that fills its beak with the water and began to go back. If he flies quickly from the lake toward the fire, on which every time leaves a small drop of them and set toward the lake and so forth. All the animals amazed by the obstinate energy of the small hummingbird, the lion king of the forest asked the question, but what do you do with a drop. There are drops of water that harbor as gift. Seriously, I answered the hummingbird.